Shalom, everyone. This is Rabbi David Vazquez. We have a great show for you today. We have a Messianic rabbi from a congregation in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. So invite your friends, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. We start right now. Shalom Mishpucha and Havarim. This is your host, Rabbi David Vazquez, and welcome to Walking in the Footsteps of the Moshiach. Today we have with us a Messianic rabbi from a congregation in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Our guest today is Rabbi Eduardo Arroyo. And let me tell you a little bit about this rabbi. Rabbi Arroyo was born in Brooklyn, New York, to Anusim parents of crypto-Jewish descent and was raised nominally in a Catholic home. He returned to Judaism in 2003 at the age of 19 after a meeting with Messianic David Rosenberg, a Nayak College campus. A couple of years later, Rabbi Eduardo moved to Pennsylvania where he met the associate Messianic rabbi of Bet Simcha, Mark Schulman, in Allentown, Pennsylvania. Rabbi Mark became a spiritual father to Rabbi Eduardo. In 2014, he married the love of his life, Rabbi Sin Amy Arroyo. They have been together for almost 10 years and married for six. They have been blessed with five sons, Javante, Elijah, Jeremiah, Aiden, and Zachariah, who is due in September of this year. In 2018, Rabbi Eduardo was ordained as a Messianic chaplain. And in 2019, received Simcha ordination as a Messianic rabbi by Rabbi Mark Schulman, Zakin Dan Zecher, and Zakin Leon Benner. He currently serves as the Associate Rabbi of Congregation Beth El Gabor. He also serves as a volunteer chaplain for the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections. Rabbi Arroyo has completed a Bachelor's of Jewish Studies and Religion Studies from Muhlenberg College in Allentown, PA, and Lord willing, will go on to do a Master's of Ancient Jewish Studies with a focus on rabbinic literature in the year 2022. Rabbi Arroyo also has a YouTube channel called Messianic Judaism Unraveled, where Messianic Jewish theology and apologetics are unraveled. Also, a fun fact, Rabbi Arroyo has been a DJ for almost 18 years and still DJs to this very day. So please, let us welcome today, as we get into this deep biblical discussion. Our topic today will be on Moshiach ben Yosef and Moshiach ben David. What is the mystery about this? Is it a mystery or is it not a mystery? We're going to find out today. Let's stay tuned. Let us welcome Rabbi Eduardo Arroyo. Shalom Aleichem, my brother. How you doing?
Shalom Aleichem, shalom, my brother. How are you, bro?
Amen. Awesome, brother. Welcome to our program. And today we're going to get into this topic. I want to thank you for coming out and joining us. And hopefully today, a lot of people are viewing because this is a very, very important and interesting topic, especially when we talk about biblical eschatology.
Important, interesting, and controversial, right?
Oh, yeah, dude. Very controversial. Very controversial.
So if you want to stick it to the side and really open up rabbinic literature and flip it on its head, you talk about Moshiach ben Yosef.
That's right, man.
It won't make an Orthodox Jew more uncomfortable than speaking about Moshiach ben Yosef,
right? That's right, that's right. Well, as before we get into this topic, I want to ask you some questions, but before we get into this topic, sure. We're going to dive a little bit later, but you know, it is a topic that's very controversial. It's a topic that most people, especially in the Christian world, have not even heard of. And even in some Messianic circles have not even heard of this. But we're going to get into it today to, you know, to reveal to the Messianic Jewish world what it is, and also to the Christian world as well. All right, so first question for you, my brother. Tell us a little bit about you being in the Associated Rabbi of Congregation Beth El Gabor, which means House of the Mighty God. How long have you been the Associated Rabbi there?
Sure, I've been the Associate Rabbi there since 2019. I studied for 5 years under Rabbi Mark Shulman before I received smicha. Part of my study was doing my undergrad at Muhlenberg College. So I've been there for 2 years. I help lead Shabbat services. I help direct the senior Shabbat school. I do help with the curriculum, discipleship, boot camp, and really all aspects of that. Rabbi Mark and myself are a team. We have four elders, Zach and Dan, and Zach and Lee as well serve with us. And we have about a dozen or more shamashim who serve, as well as deacon and deaconesses in our community.
Oh, wow, that's awesome, dude. For awesome
So that's a large number for a smaller congregation.
Oh,
right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
When you talk about 80, 90 people, you have 20 people who are in leadership, right, leading and serving, and we're blessed by the Lord for that.
That is awesome. You don't have too many congregations, especially Messianic congregations, that may have that many people in their community that are helping in leadership positions. So before you became the rabbi there, I mean, what made you, what was the calling that God gave you? You said, you know what, this is the calling I feel that Hashem has given me to become a rabbi.
You know, it's whenever I want to do, I go extreme. Yeah. So if I'm going to be in the club, I want to be the DJ, right? If I'm going to be in the synagogue, right? And it's not because myself just wants that. It's how the Lord designed me, that when I'm into something, I need to be 100%, 1,000% into that thing. So just wanting it wasn't enough, right? The Lord really called me to that thing because of this burning desire to serve in this way, in this capacity. So it's really, really not much more than that, right? You know, it can't be the flesh that makes you want to do these things.
Oh, no, definitely not.
You're visiting people, you know, you're bearing the burdens of the community. You know, this can't be a flesh thing. It's definitely, I recognize that it was the Spirit of God who did that, who wanted to do that for me.
Amen. And of course, you know, if the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit of God, was involved, it also had to open the eyes of your senior rabbi as well to ask you to be his associate.
Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something about this man, Rabbi Mark Shulman. When I first, and you know, I've shared this before with other people, and you know, I've shared this in the community, but I'll share it again publicly because it's part of the testimony. When I first told Rabbi Mark, and I told him, I said, you know, I feel like I have a calling on my life to be a Messianic rabbi. You know what he told me? He said, well, you need to get it together because nobody's going to take you serious the way you are now. Right? And so this just shows, right, the straightforwardness, right, the discernment of the man of God, right, to call it as it is and say, look, you need to get it together. And, you know, we're talking a decade and a half ago, right? And the Lord has worked through me and worked through him and worked through the community to get me to where I need to be. I was just talking to his wife, Rebbe Sam Rangina. She was just saying, you know, it's awesome to see the man of God that you become. And I told her, look, I wouldn't be the man of God I am if not for the leadership. And right, that is the reality. If not for my wife, if not for the leadership helping to be there with me, we couldn't be the men of God that we are, right?
Amen, amen. Yeah, you have to have some type of role model to at least, you know, to show you the way, how to be, you know, the person that maybe that God wants you to be, the complete person that Hashem wants you to be.
Amen.
Amen. And how did your wife take all this? You know, did she say, when you said to her, listen, honey, by the way, you know, I got this calling, and you know, it's boiling in my blood, and I, you know, I think it's the Ruach of Hashem telling me I'm going to be a rabbi. How did that work out?
So when I received smicha, it's actually on our YouTube channel. It was during a Shabbat service. So you can see, and then my wife was sharing a little bit. She was like, you know, I thought I was going to marry, you know, a white guy in the country. Maybe we'll go to church every now and again. It's all good. Now I got a Puerto Rican Jewish rabbi. And I'm a rabbi. She goes, I was not expecting this turn to happen, right?
Right.
But she received it, and we're all in, man. And, you know, struggles, battles, things become difficult, but the Lord provides his mercy, right?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I mean, we were speaking a couple of shows ago to Rabbi Carlos Perdomo, who's also a Messianic worship singer. And he was just recently here at a congregation giving a concert. And he was saying, man, when you're called to the ministry, before you say yes to Adonai, make sure that you're making the right decision, because you're pretty much opening the door to every attack that the enemy, you know, will throw at you, basically.
Yeah. I was driving home from my secular job last night. I was thinking, you know, I see more tired days coming, right? Of leaders and community needing to be busy, right? With things like this, right? Sharing the knowledge, sharing the information, visiting the sick, doing the work of the ministry, right?
Right.
These times are coming. And then when I thought about that, I was like, man, I'm going to be, because I'm tired already. I had Shabbat service all day, led services. I gave this message yesterday. Go to work at nighttime, right? Get home at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, you know what? I'm tired. And then I felt that whisper from the Lord, right?
Yeah.
I'm going to take care of you, though. I'll refresh you. You might be tired, but I'll sustain you and get you to the end.
Yeah, and that's pretty much it. You know, most of us, you know, like, I don't know about other people. I know some people, you know, maybe do the ministry for a living, and that's it. But I also have a secular job, and I understand. Yeah. I'm on my feet standing for 8 hours, and I got to come to the synagogue, and I'm here. I'm doing Bible studies. I'm doing weddings. Yeah. I'm doing whatever, you know. So and then I got the show and other things that go on. So it does take a lot of our time. And then, you know, we have that family time. We have to be with our families as well, which doesn't make it any easier. But it's something that, you know, our wives have to be, of course, loving wives, supportive wives, that when our arms are falling down, they raise our arms up, you know, to give us that strength that we need to continue. Amen.
Yeah.
And awesome. So your wife took this well. That's good.
Yeah, we're good now. Look,
After the first year or the second year?
Yeah, you know what it is? I think, you know, as men, we're vision casters, right?
Right.
As rabbis, we're vision casters. You know, we hear from the Lord the direction to go. You know, sometimes we hear more clearly than other times, right? Our wives are there to be that buffer also, right?
Yeah.
You know, are you hearing right? This is that pushback. The Lord will speak through our wives, right?
That's right.
You know, one of the main times scripture tells us that our prayers will be blocked is if we don't treat our wives properly, right?
That's right.
Right?
That's
with your prayers, you know, it's the Lord gives our wives a very big role in our relationships to the Lord, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there was that conversation there, right? About, you know, doing this and becoming part of it. She's been fully supportive. And, you know, but you know, there is that reality of building a ministry where
right.
there's that back and forth, right? Can we do this? How can we do this? This is time consuming. I just had to talk with my 2-year. I said, look, daddy has to do some work for a little bit. And then we'll go to the store and I'll buy you toys.
Right.
Because, you know, I have to, you know, I got a reason with him that he's still just as important as all the other things I do. You know, my family ministry is just as important as all these other ministry things, right?
Of course.
No less of the role that the Lord gave me, right?
Amen. Amen. Yeah, I mean, I understand that, you know, in my situation, because I am the senior rabbi here, you know, it's like I have another rabbi who's part of our association, but he doesn't live here in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. He lives, you know, further out in Pennsylvania. But he only comes for special occasions. So, but what happens is, you know, you're doing it by yourself. You know, you have your wife. You know, you have your elders. You know, we have about 6 elders here and stuff like that, which is pretty good. Yeah. People work out
That's
and
great.
Stuff. But in the same sense, you know, you know, I remember when I first took over the place, and it was hard because you're doing all the work. But you know what? It pays out. You know, at the end, it pays off. You know, but your wife has to support you, has to deal with your temperament, deal with all the nonsense that goes on. You know, but the blessing is there at the end.
Yeah,
that's
agreed,
pretty much
agreed.
It. Yeah, so that's good. That's good that your wife is supportive.
Thank the Lord for our wives, right?
Thank Hashem for our wives.
Oh, man. Amen. You tell you something, brother.
You know, that's all you can do is, you know, just praise God the night. And you know, you're a busy man. In the sense that you have your kids. I can see myself, you know, like, oh, and then you have another one on the way. You know, I have my youngest is 4 years old. So, you know, that kind of drives me a little bit crazy. So I could imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
But
No doubt,
bless you, my brother. Bless you. Yeah. May God bless you.
It makes me laugh because, you know, I have my son in my arms, and then, you know, so he's 2. You know, so we're talking about stuff. He's like, "Daddy, what's that?" I'm like, "Oh, that's a sefer Torah." He goes, "Daddy, what's that?" Ner Tamid. I was like, "Can you say?" He goes, "Ner Tamid," and he's happy that he said it right.
So
it's amazing, man, to have the kids and to be able to raise them in the ministry and let them see the things. I mean, it's an awesome thing, you know.
That's good. That's good. That's awesome. Also, listen. You also have a YouTube show called Messianic Judaism Unraveled. Tell me a little bit more about that.
So Messianic Judaism Unraveled came out of the pandemic where I had a lot of time on my hands. I had a hip replacement at the point, and I'd always wanted to create a show where I can talk about theology and apologetics from a Messianic perspective. Uh-huh. Now, those exist out there, right? Plenty of shows that try to do that. I just felt that I had something to say also. Right.
Amen.
I have a view. I have a perspective. I have an idea, and I might differ with others. So to put what I believe is out there and that the Lord has put inside of me through my study. So I did, you know, a handful of episodes with that. And then the Lord told me, look, I want you to do some studying of languages. So I've been studying rabbinic Hebrew. I've been studying going back to biblical Hebrew, kind of understanding rabbinic literature a little bit better, trying to get a grasp of Jewish, Babylonian, Aramaic. Uh-huh. So to understand the languages in the text. So that's a lot of what I've been spending a lot of my time on. But I do have some episodes in the pot cooking, getting ready to come out.
Good.
So I have some topics, some ideas, some things to talk about. So
now, yeah, and these episodes, and these episodes, these shows that you have. I know that I think I see one or two of your episodes that you actually interview guests themselves. Is it mostly you talking, or are you interviewing people? And
what do you mean?
Are you
guests? No, I haven't interviewed guests.
I think that was one with the Orthodox rabbi.
No. That's Rabbi Asher Meza. He's an Orthodox rabbi.
Right, right.
So I know what you're talking about. So Asher Meza is an Orthodox rabbi. What he does is he interviews a whole bunch of people, Messianics, Christians, Orthodox Jews, other Jews, whatever, right, atheists. And he just tries to get their perspective. He has his perspective. So
right,
we kind of hashed it out. And it started as a discussion.
Right, right.
And then everybody in the comments said, this should be a debate. Right? This should be titled as a debate.
Right.
Look, I think the brother has his cause. I think he's thorough. He has a framework. You know, I disagree with that framework.
Right.
But it's always a respectful dialogue, which I appreciate.
Oh, okay. So it's basically his show. He was interviewing you. Was that
yeah.
what was doing? Yep. Okay, yep. Gotcha.
And he gave me permission to repost it. So, and that was really fun. That was a fun conversation and dialogue.
Are you planning on your show in the future to, I guess, then invite guests to do interviews, or is it just basically your
I do.
Thoughts?
You know, I think once I start creating more content, mm-hmm. I think I'm going to get more people that really agree mm-hmm. and want to talk about what I talked about, or really disagree and want to talk about what I talked about, right?
Yeah.
So you're going to get the guys who agree with you, the guys who disagree with you, and then they're going to come on the show and talk about it. So I think it's going to be an organic thing where people are going to say, look, dude, what you said is totally wrong, and I'm going to tell you why.
Mm-hmm.
Or we're going to have people say, I love what you said, love to talk about it more, right? So I think that's what's going to happen more so than anything.
Awesome. So we'll be looking forward to your show, looking and see if those little things happen there, you know, because we've got to be supportive. You know, we're Messianic rabbis. We're doing this, you know, for the Lord, and want to support each other's ministry. And I want to make sure that this Messianic movement, especially, you know, if we have rabbis that are willing to put themselves out there and speak these discussions, these topics that no one else wants to talk about, you know, and I think it's awesome. I think it's great.
And you know, what I've noticed is that the ones who do want to talk about it usually go so far in the pendulum swing that it's not constructive for the body, right?
Yeah.
But we're trying to build a kingdom, man. We're not just here to write academic papers.
Yes.
Look, there's a place for academic papers.
Yes.
But we're not here for just theoretically on the high end thinking mm-hmm. about some of these biblical concepts, right? Mm-hmm. We want them to be something where it can solidify our faith, make us stronger in Messiah, help us to develop a mature Messianic Judaism that we can hand over to our children.
Amen. And that's the main goal. And I think also that the fact that we are living in the last days, and the fact that we have a lot of people of the nations coming into Messianic congregations because they want to know more, it is our job, our duty as Messianic believers and leaders to instruct them the right way, you know, and show them the truth, not, you know, with a whole bunch of Jewish theology and just leave them out there, you know. We want to make sure we instruct them, show them the word of Hashem.
Like, thanks, man, but, you know, I keep fighting with my wife every day. I get Moshiach ben Yosef, but I can't stop fighting with my wife, right? You know, right? You know, let's help the people, right? Let's get them to root. Let's solidify them in the faith. And, you know, this Moshiach ben Yosef, Moshiach ben David topic, concept, the point of it and the key of really getting into it is to keep the people who believe in Moshiach believing in Moshiach, right?
That's right.
So that the rabbinic literature is not mystified, so that their ears are tingled, right? I believe there's a religious spirit, a spirit of religiosity that likes the spirit of Gnosticism, the spirit of knowledge, right?
That
rabbinic literature seems so dense and so deep that many in our movement get enticed by it
uh-huh.
to the point so much that they are consumed by it that they eventually leave Messiah.
Yes. They're searching and searching, and I think sometimes they're not searching with the right purpose or have the right goal in mind, and mm-hmm. and they get lost
mm-hmm.
in searching for knowledge. Instead of looking at it and saying, you know, asking the Ruach Kodesh, which is our teacher, the one who's guiding us and showing us about Yeshua, to help us, they're too busy focused on their own goals, their own, you know, whatever they want to do, and then they wind up getting lost. And deceived by Hasatan, because you know Hasatan is out there. He will deceive you, and he knows how to do it. He's been doing it for thousands of years. So you know we can't think of ourselves bigger than him, that we know more than him when he has been around, and that we just have to be focused on what God has for us, and try to stick to the main thing, and let the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, show us who the Moshiach is, you know, and especially as Jewish believers, you know, we have all the authority in Yeshua. You know, God has chosen us to be the sign to the world, shown us to teach the world. So, brother, let's do it. Amen.
Let's get it done.
Amen. All right. Now we're going to get into this topic that we've been talking about, all right? So today we're definitely going to be talking some biblical topics. We're going to dive into this study, this biblical topic on Moshiach ben Yosef and Moshiach ben David. For those who've never heard of this topic before, this is going to be a blessing for you. And those who have heard of this topic, maybe don't know too much of it, it'll also be a blessing to you as well. So Moshiach ben David, what does the word ben mean? It means son. So we see Moshiach, son of Joseph, Moshiach, son of David. So, okay, now, who are these characters? Who are these prophetic characters or people refer to? Who are they? So we're going to get into that today, and we're just going to let Rabbi show us a little bit of knowledge here, of what he knows. So Rabbi Eduardo, can you explain to all of our viewers, not just Messianic believers, but also the nations out there, what is this concept of Moshiach ben Yosef and Moshiach ben David?
So imagine I have a big, deep beard, and I'm stroking it because of my wisdom right now. Just kidding.
Mine was much bigger, but I kind of cut off.
Yeah. I had a longer one. If you look at my podcast, I had a longer beard.
Yeah, I remember,
and I kind of cut it off. So let's get to the basics, right? I want to get to the root. After Yeshua is resurrected and he's on the walk into the road to Emmaus and he's with these two disciples and they don't recognize him and he's talking to them and he says, you know, all these crazy things happen. Yeshua's like, what things have happened? And Yeshua's hidden from them, right? And he goes on and says to them, oh, foolish men and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Mm-hmm. Was it necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? Then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in the scriptures, Luke 24. This is the concept, this is the point, that Mashiach, when he comes back, when the Messiah comes back and he speaks to the people, he says, all the things that you've experienced, these aren't things that I came and made up. These are things that are found in the prophets. These are things that Moses spoke about and all the writings, they speak about me. Uh-huh. So when we look at Moshiach ben David, Moshiach ben Yosef, when we talk about these roles of the Messiah, these are roles of the Messiah that have been developed from ideas in the Tanakh. So the Tanakh gives us ideas, images, and glimmers into the roles of what the Messiah would do. And then what happens is that rabbinic literature, the rabbis, have gone on and tried to make heads and tails of these roles, right?
Okay.
So in starting with Messiah ben David, what happens? In 2 Samuel 7, what says is that he shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. This speaks about the son of David.
Amen.
Now, here goes the problem. You read the book of Chronicles, you read the book of Kings, you want to throw the book against the wall because these kings suck so bad, right? Uh-huh. They're terrible kings. They're no good. None of them fulfill the role of this King David. The idea is that there would be one who would sit on the throne of David, who will come from David, who will be a reigning king. And this reigning king won't be a king for a day or a week or until his grandma, Queen Athaliah, kills all his kids, right? Which we know happens in scripture, right? This kingdom will never end. And this is where we get the idea of King David, Moshiach ben David, that there will be one who comes from David who will be the Messiah, the anointed one, who will never stop being the anointed one, who will continually reign forever. So deep is the idea of Moshiach ben David. I want to share a story. I was DJing an Orthodox bar mitzvah in Long Island.
Right.
400, 500 people. Synagogue so huge, Rabbi David, that inside of their synagogue, attached to it, they had a recreational center that held a banquet with a full staff serving food.
Wow.
All right? So I'm standing next to the bar, and there's this little kid there, and it was about, I was about 8 years ago at the beginning of the election, and the little kid goes up to, must have been his uncle or his dad, he's an older Orthodox guy, long beard. He goes, who do you want to be president? And the guy turns to the little boy and says, Moshiach ben David, right? That even in the moment of a bar mitzvah, in a party that's happening, right, this Orthodox Jew sitting at a bar top, having a drink, celebrating, and enjoying in a conversation with a little boy who's a family member, says that the one he wants to reign is Moshiach ben David.
Wow.
You understand?
Yeah. I mean, this is something like, you know, for example, for our viewers that don't know too much about this, you know, this concept is nothing new. You know, as a matter of fact, it's called the dual concept of Messiah, of Moshiach. Jewish tradition speaks of two redeemers, one which is called Moshiach, Ben David and Moshiach Ben Yosef, you know, both are involved in ushering the Messianic era. So this is something that when do we first see a glimpse of this? Do we see this, you know, before Christ? Do we see this after Christ? Wow. You know, before the Common Era or the Common Era itself? You know, that's the question. Where do we find this information from?
So rooting it in the Tanakh, right? We've talked about Moshiach ben David, right? Uh-huh. The Messiah, son of David. Uh-huh. But then we have this role of Moshiach ben Yosef. And this goes all the, we haven't even begun to touch the rabbinic literature and their ideas about this yet, right?
Right.
We rooted it in Yeshua saying, look, all the prophets talk about me. And we've rooted it in the fact that David will have a son who will sit on a throne forever. When we go to the popular passages of Isaiah 53, we find one who is the servant of Adonai, who suffers on behalf of his people. Uh-huh. Not only does he suffer on behalf of his people, his very death becomes an asham. It becomes an offering for the people. We have substitutionary sacrifice. Uh-huh. And the prophet Isaiah didn't wake up one morning and say, dude, I'm going to kill him with this one. I'm going to hit him with Isaiah 53. I'm going to write this because this is going to be good, right?
That is the forbidden chapter in Judaism, by the way.
Yeah, it is. And it's not in the weekly readings, right? Mm-hmm. It is actually skipped over. You mm-hmm. go from 51 to all the way to the end, and you go straight to 54, right? There's no Isaiah 53 read. But it's forbidden now.
Well, it's forbidden now because when we address it, we especially not so much us, but the Christian world say, well, that's the chapter of the Messiah. And they go, no, let's not talk about Messiah. Let's talk about Israel. Let's get the facts straight.
Yep.
Yeah, that's why.
Yeah, so we don't have this idea of substitutionary sacrifice goes even further back to the idea of the death of the high priest. You know, we have in the scriptures, you know, I didn't take the notes for this, but just thinking off the top of the head as the spirit leads, there is the idea that when someone kills someone, that they have to go to the city of refuge. Why? You need to go to city of refuge because you know what? Those boys are going to come get you, right? The family members of those are going to get the retribution for the wrong killing that you did to their family member. Uh-huh. So the person who committed the offense, if you make it to the city of refuge, you can stay there, and the one who would take revenge will not get you, right? Uh-huh. The manslayer won't come get you. So this is the idea. During the death of the high priest, after the high priest dies, that person is able to be freed from that place, and they can leave the city of refuge.
Right.
Why can they leave the city of refuge? The rabbis teach, and they all teach in one voice, that the death of the high priest provides a substitutionary sacrifice. It provides an atonement, what we call in Hebrew a kapara, for the person who committed the offense, right?
Amen.
This is deeply rooted, and we haven't even gone into the rabbis
yet. And this is the thing, okay? This is what we want to make sure people understand, okay? This is not a concept that was just developed yesterday. This is a concept that goes back, and it probably exists in the first century BCE. So one of the things we have to understand, that's how far it goes. You know, and BCE is before the Common Era, okay? That's pretty much a secular way of saying before Christ, okay? Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure people understand that. And in that time period, this is where this theology came from and is deeply rooted in the Midrash and the Talmud mm-hmm. and even in the Zohar. And this is things mm-hmm. that we need to understand because they also go along with the Tanakh and the B'rit HaDeshah also gets involved later on as part mm-hmm. of this dual concept of Moshiach.
Mm-hmm. So before we jump into all that stuff, right, I just want to hinge it again, right, because as the rabbis are reading the Tanakh, one thing, if you talk to religious Jews, right, religious Jews know the text, right?
Correct.
They know the text. The problem and why most believers have not been effective in witnessing to religious Jewish people today is that they don't read the text for plainly what the text says. Uh-huh. They look at it through the lens of the way the rabbis have understood it.
Right.
So you don't read the Tanakh by yourself. You read the Tanakh with Rashi.
Correct.
You have to. This is how you do it, right? But let's look at these two passages that show us two pictures of the Messiah. Daniel 7:13, it says, I kept looking in the night of visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man was coming, and he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. We have this son of man riding a clouds, distinct from the Ancient of Days, who is Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, he's the father, right? We have
That's
the
right.
son who is approaching him. This divine being comes up to him, and all authority and dominion is given to the son of man. This right. is an image that we have. The rabbis say this is Messiah.
Right.
Then we have this other passage, Zechariah 9:9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. And
That's
how
right.
he's coming? In a Tesla electric charge, right?
Yep,
with self-driving down to Jerusalem. That's not the thing. He comes how to you? Humble. Mounted on donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey,
right?
That this king
But that
of
was
Israel,
the Cadillac back in those days.
It was the caddy for the daddy. I get
right,
that.
Right, right.
But he was riding on this donkey, mm-hmm. right?
That's right.
Coming humbly, right? On what is earthly, right? The donkey symbolizes what is natural in this existence, what is earthly. So he comes riding on this earthly donkey, right? And he rides into there. What's interesting, this is the humbleness of the king. So the question is, does he come in a clouds? Does he come in a donkey? Does he come in a clouds? Does he come in a donkey? This is the issue and this is the problem. The rabbis had an issue with this.
That's right.
Exactly. So then this is the question. So we go to Sanhedrin 98a. Let's deal with what the rabbis say. The rabbis go in and they're looking at this. They said, so Rabbi Alexander, he says, look, it's written and it's time the Messiah will come. And it's also written, the Lord will hasten it. They're battling this thing. What is the meaning of the difference of these things? He says, if the Israelites, if the Jewish people have merit, meaning if they're good, I will hasten it. If they don't, the Messiah will not come in due time. So there's the wrestling where the rabbis want to hinge the coming of the Messiah on the behavior of the Jewish people.
That's right. And that's basically all it's about.
Mashiach's never going to come.
It's basically what it's about. This is the whole thing about it. Before these two Moshiachs, because actually they believe both of them are coming. Before these two Moshiach comes, is based on, just like you said, on the behavior of the Jewish people in Israel. What is the condition of Israel's state for them? Yeah. Now, if the condition is right, then Moshiach ben Yosef will come. If the condition is wrong, he won't come. And then the other one will come. So it's like a back and forth.
Well, you see different things. You see differences.
Yes.
I mean, there's different voices, right? Some mm-hmm. is either or, and
either
that's
or.
What this is going to get into. Some it's either or. Some is both and we're gonna. And I have some sources here that talk about the both and how they work together.
Right.
And this passage right here in Sanhedrin 98a shows us the distinction of Moshiach ben David versus Moshiach ben Yosef.
Uh-huh.
And I submit that it's not founded in the scriptures because Zechariah and Daniel both didn't say this might happen. They say it will. So continue in Sanhedrin 98a. It says, if the Israelites have merit, meaning if they're worthy, he will come with the clouds of heaven. They said, if they don't, he will be lowly and riding on a donkey, right?
Yes.
So,
yes.
And they quote those passages. This is the either or passage, right?
That's right.
This is something that develops in rabbinic literature that is problematic because what they've done is, what the rabbis and the sages have done is, they've added something into the text that's not plainly there. This is not conditional. Nowhere in the text, if they're good, he comes like this. If he's bad, they come like that.
Correct.
Text plainly says he will come
both ways,
right? So rooting it back to Yeshua, this is why Yeshua has two comings. He comes first as Mashiach ben Yosef, and then he will come as Mashiach ben David.
Before we get into that, because that's like the bread and butter at the end. We want to get before that. We need to get more into the concept of Mashiach ben Yosef. So this is the question. So we have two. We're looking at now in this. We're looking at two Mashiachs. Okay.
Yeah.
We have one that's called the suffering servant. Okay, which is Mashiach mm-hmm. ben Yosef. We have one which is the conquering king, Mashiach ben David. Mm-hmm. Okay, but the strange thing here is they're from two different tribes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, they're not from the same tribe, so they're not, you know. One has come from the tribe of Judah and the other one has come from the tribe of Ephraim. Okay? So
yeah.
This is the thing we have to understand. The tribe of Judah is Moshiach ben David, the tribe of Benjamin. Ephraim is Moshiach ben Yosef, okay? So I wanted to read this real quick so people can understand what we're talking about here because we don't want to get too far into jumping about Yeshua because we know who Yeshua is. But we want to set up the stage and how we got to this concept before we get to Yeshua and how Yeshua can fulfill either one or both of these concepts, okay? So the term Moshiach unqualifies always refers to Moshiach ben David, okay? Moshiach is the descendant of David of the tribe of Judah. He is an actual final redeemer who shall rule in the Messianic age. All that is said in our text relates to him. Moshiach ben Yosef is the Moshiach, descendant of Joseph, of the tribe of Ephraim, the son of Joseph. He's also referred to as Moshiach ben Ephraim, Moshiach, the descendant of Ephraim. He will come first, according to Jewish tradition, before the final redeemer, and later will serve, okay, as his viceroy. So we see this, that he comes before. So it's almost like, you know, saying, okay, so wait a minute. So they're saying that one is coming before the other one, okay? And then the essential part is here, one has one specific role, and one has another specific role, okay? Mm-hmm. And then relating this, not going too far with Yeshua, but Yeshua, some rabbis today, looking at the perspective and thinking about this ideology between these two Moshiach, okay, we don't believe that Yeshua is the Messiah. Ben David, we could possibly believe that he could be Moshiach ben Yosef. But there's a reason why they say they believe that. And we're going to get into that in a few seconds, okay? So basically, you know, we're looking at these two messianic concepts, where they came from, okay, and how long they've been around, okay? And we were going to touch on this, like, were they existing in the time of Yeshua? Do we see this in the Brit HaDeshah, which we do? And I'm going to show later on where that concept comes from in the Brit HaDeshah, okay? But you won't see it unless you know about it, all right?
No doubt. And I think, and so, you know, continuing with the sources, right, that predate Yeshua and around the time of Yeshua, you know, we have these targums, these manuscripts that go back, you know, very, very old, and they represent ideas that would have been mainstream within the traditional, you know, world of Yeshua and predating the world of Yeshua. So
that's right.
And if you know the Midrashic text, right, they can take one verse and, man, it will be a verse about a tree, and they would say, look, man, in the future we're going to have flying cars because this tree sprouts so high, right?
Yeah.
This is kind of like how the Midrash talks, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and Psalms 4 or 5, you know, Midrash text, but also the Targums do these things as well, right?
That's
where
right.
The Targums, too, can be a sort of thing. So we have this commentary on Psalms 4 or 5, right, which says, your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle which feed among the lilies, right? And so this is how it comes down to us in the manuscript. It said, your two redeemers who are destined to redeem you, Messiah, son of David, and Messiah, son of Ephraim, resemble Moses and Aaron, the sons of Jochebed. And by their merit, they fed the people of the house of Israel for 40 years in the wilderness on manna, plumb fowl, and the water of Miriam's well. So we have the idea of redemption be nestled in the idea of these two roles of these redeemers, which are these two redeemers.
But, you know, the interesting part of all this is we're talking about two roles, okay?
Yeah.
But it goes even further than that, because the beginning of this concept, okay, was actually alluded to four messianic figures that will come out. Okay, even before
going
this,
way back, man.
Yeah, I'm going way back, you know, because sometimes I have to get
back,
okay. So when it gets into
told
this,
me, I'm gonna put my floaties on if we're going that deep, brother. You should have told me, man.
Well, the whole concept about this is, you know, in the Jewish tradition, okay, it alludes to four messianic figures, okay, called the four craftsmen, okay, and they're taken from the vision from the book of Zechariah. Okay, so these four craftsmen, according to, you know, the Babylonian Talmud, Suk 52b, Rav Hana bar Binzna, attributes to Rav Simon Hasida, identifies these four craftsmen as Moshiach ben David, Moshiach ben Yosef, Elijah, okay, and the righteous priest. So now that's how far back these concepts go. And then now they brought it back down to having two, you know, which is
so
interesting.
These Gemaras are really 600, 700, 800, you know. So, I mean, these Targums go for, you know, a lot of these Targums and stuff go further back, you know.
Right.
And, you know, we have this thread of this role. Remember, so for people watching the show, and, you know, Rabbi David, we talked about this earlier. The idea is not just to teach you rabbinic concepts for the sake of rabbinic concepts, right? But the point is this, to understand that within the traditions of Israel, within traditions of the rabbis, they have viewed the text in such a way that it's consistent with the revelation of Yeshua in the New Covenant. This is the key.
So not just
to pick up all these concepts, but to get that our belief in Yeshua, the New Covenant belief of Yeshua, the way he is represented in the Brit HaDeshah, the New Covenant, is kosher within some of the voices of Orthodoxy.
Amen.
Do all the rabbis agree? No, all the rabbis don't agree. All the rabbis don't agree about anything.
No. And it's always you see this in the Midrash. In the Midrash, there's always a dispute between the rabbis. I believe this, believe this. No, it says this, you know, and they start quoting the other rabbis who said this, you know. And you see that throughout, you know, Judaism, we do that. That is a common thing.
Yeah. And they challenge each other, too. I forget where it's at, but I was reading this one passage in the Talmud that two rabbis are disagreeing about when Yom Kippur is.
Yeah.
And so the one rabbi says, no, this is this day. No, it's that day. And then the one who's the higher authority, he says, if you believe it's on your day, then on the day that I say Yom Kippur, come to me with your bag and your staff in your hand and walk up to me and come break Yom Kippur, break the prohibition against Yom Kippur for carrying and doing this work if you don't believe it's Yom Kippur. And he didn't do it, right?
That's right.
So, you know. You know, so the point is they challenge each other, too. And so this is, too, an open challenge to the Orthodox world and other Jews who don't believe in Yeshua, right? View these texts. tell me that the new covenant is not kosher. Try to tell me that the new covenant does not fit the worldview of the Jewish people. I was on a Facebook group and I got told that I believe in that I'm committing the worst type of avera, which is a transgression because of believing in Yeshua.
Really?
Right? And I said, listen, brother, you can't tell me that I'm committing the worst type of avera when you would count Kabbalah Bavarcher people who believe Schneerson is God, right? That their Rebbe is God and have no problem with them, yet commit me, you slander me. And this is, you know, to break it down for people, there is a sect and there are many groups within the Chabad who believe that the seventh rabbi of the rabbinic dynasty of their leaders, their group, a Hasidic group, that he, Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, was the Messiah.
Yes.
They believe that he is an Atzmut in a group, the divine essence in a body. They believe Isaiah 53 applies to him, right? So we have a 21st century modern interpretation of applying Isaiah 53 to a Messiah type figure.
Yes,
believe he is the walking Shekhinah, right? Yes. The presence of God on earth, right? What we believe is not really such an opposition to what they believe about their Rebbe, right?
Right.
So really, it's bigoted against the Messianic community to say that I'm committing such an avera because of my belief in Yeshua as Mashiach, when it's completely kosher within voices of Judaism. It's crazy.
It is crazy, you know, and that's one thing that, you know, we want our viewers to understand, you know. You know, Judaism is not a simple thing. You know, when you get into Judaism, you get to study, you know, all these things. You get to study the Midrash, the Mishnah, the Talmud, you know, the Zohar, you know. And you get to study all these things. And according with Tanakh and the Brother Shah, you realize, wow, there's a lot of, like, discussions going on here. A lot of concepts that are being thrown around. But each one, if you really look deep into them, you know, us as Messianic rabbis, we're showing people what the text says in the ancient times, what it says in modern times, to show you where Moshiach, you know, which is Yeshua, lies in there. And we can show you very clearly, you know, and even with this particular concept that we're dealing with now, you know, it reveals to you two different roles of two separate individuals. But at the same time, looking at what each role of these individuals were going to bring, for example, you know, Moshiach ben Yosef was supposed to be a suffering servant. As a matter of fact, Moshiach ben Yosef was supposed to be a political leader. And according to Jewish tradition, he was to be put to death in battle.
Yeah.
So then you look at that and say, okay, why do some Orthodox rabbis say, okay, then we could understand that maybe Yeshua could have been Moshiach ben Yosef because of the fact that he was put to death. And at some point, some people could say he was like a political rebel of his age, of his time.
A Messiah for the Gentiles.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Sometimes, you know, you'll hear that more than often not, right? And you'll see, he's a Messiah for the Gentiles. He brought monotheistic religion to many nations. So he is a Messiah for the nations. The problem is, for someone to be a true prophet, this is something we haven't prepared or talked about, but this is a true concept. For someone to be a true prophet, for someone to be a true Mashiach, for someone to do the things that Yeshua did, you have to look at the claims that he made.
That's right.
And the claims that he made about himself are not consistent with one who can be a redeemer for Israel, right? He's a liar, he's a lunatic, right? He has all these issues that don't make it to be true because he doesn't claim to be a light for the nations in the sense that only a light for the nations and not for Israel, right? He claims to have come only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
That's right.
And then he claims that he will make his disciples a light to the nation as his light is in them, right?
This
way that it flows out is not the way that the Orthodox community presents him, which is heavily problematic. He's a good guy. He's kind of a liar, and you know, gets seen in other
contradicts. How can you be a good guy and be a liar and then be a prophet? You can't.
And look, he's a Messiah. He's a Messiah for the nations. He's all good, but you know what? Right now, he's burning in excrement. Right. This is what the Talmud teaches us. Right. The Talmud says that he is burning in excrement. God forbid. Right. So what happens, right? What happens is when we present, going back to Messiah ben Yosef and Messiah ben David, is that when we present it to the Jewish people, when we ourselves look at it and we see these conflicting views, what do we have to do? We have to go back to the source and say, what does the Tanakh really teach?
That's right.
And so that's why I started with those passages that are the biblical passages that really give us the true foundation of the absolute truth of the Messiah.
Correct. And that's one of the things that we have to understand because, see, in order to discuss this topic, in order for us to show you what traditional Judaism believes, you know, we have to address, you know, what does the scriptures say. Not other scriptures, other literature, but what the scripture says, the Tanakh, you know, the Brother Shah. You know, and as Rabbi was saying there, he was saying, he was showing you these verses in the Tanakh, revealing to you, you know, where some of this concept comes from, you know. But we know that, you know, they're going to allude a lot to these other books, but we have to base everything on what the Word of God says. The Word of God is above, you know, every other source that Judaism has. Even though in Judaism, the Word of God is actually in last place, and the Zohar is their first place. But, you know, we want to make sure we show this.
Depends who you talk to, right?
That's right.
Depends who you talk to, right? You know, but look, what I believe that has been a plague of orthodoxy in relationship to what you said is that they don't know where they're getting their sources from.
Correct.
Right. And so this is what I mean. This is the value of a rabbi like Ashemeza. Orthodox doesn't believe in Yeshua. Right. My views are clear. You can read the video. I mean, I've talked to him about it. I've expressed my views clearly. But what he does do for the Orthodox world, and he has a huge thing going on with other Orthodox rabbis where they have a problem with him, is that he wants to take them back to the sources of the five books and the Mishnah. Mm-hmm. Now, I would say you need to go back to the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. He would say it's the Torah and the Mishnah. But we're one step closer to really getting to the source of what's what. And this is what we need to do, right? We need to get back to the source,
correct,
remove the fluff, Genesis to Revelation, and find out what God says. I want to throw something in there, too, about another passage that the rabbis teach about the two messiahs working together. And it says, you know, when it talks about when Messiah, son of David, sees the Messiah, son of Joseph, killed, he would say before God, Lord of the age, I ask you for only life. And then he would say to him, life, the Lord is saying, before you spoke of it, David, your father, had already prophesied about you, as it is said. He asked for life of you. You gave it to him, even length of days forever and ever. Psalm 21:5. So the idea is that the rabbis teach that there is. They want to separate Messiah ben Yosef and Messiah ben David.
That's right.
But the reality is, somehow, by a force of interpreting the text, they are constantly pulled back together. Uh-huh. They can't separate, right?
Because
the roles
are
in a weave.
Correct. Right.
And yet they want to.
And that's the thing we have to understand, because, see, in looking at this, and looking at how we look at Yeshua, how we look at these two Moshiach, these two concepts, and understanding who Yeshua was, you know. Now, question, Rabbi, you know, and
sure,
for our viewers. So, in your understanding, do you believe, because of this concept and what the Jewish people believed, okay, even in the time of Yeshua, they believe this. So, do you believe when Yeshua came to fulfill two roles? One as a suffering servant, as a conquering king.
So I don't think that's a fast answer, and I'm going to tell you why.
Okay.
Because the lowly passage of the Messiah identifies him as a king, right? So this role of him coming in the lowly status doesn't remove kingship.
Correct.
And that is the big conundrum and the problem that when I would talk to Orthodox rabbis or if I came into a conversation with them, I would have to say, you say Moshiach ben Yosef and Moshiach ben David. Moshiach ben David's the king. Moshiach ben Yosef is a suffering servant. But the passages themselves don't make a distinction between the kingship and the roles that he comes
in, right? That's right.
Even at his crucifixion, right? He is called King of Israel, Melech Yisrael. He's not called the Eved Yisrael, right?
That's
He's
right.
not the servant of Israel, right?
That's right?
In this role, his kingship remains. And this is a head nod to the complexity of his nature, that he is fully God and fully man, right?
Correct.
He doesn't put down godness when he takes on a flesh,
correct,
right? We don't believe God transformed into a man.
Correct.
We believe that God, the second person of the triune God, took on flesh and walked amongst us and paid the price for us. Without putting down godness, but allowing to relieve him, but relieving himself of some of his attributes in the sense of knowing everything. Sometimes he put that off. Sometimes he picked it up. He knew the hearts of man, but he doesn't know the hour of the return, right? There's certain things that we find where there is a tension in the scriptures.
Uh-huh.
And this is the same thing with that role as him coming as king. He reigns as king. When Stephen was put to death and he's sitting up, where does he see? He doesn't see him on a donkey
in
Shemayim up in heaven.
Right.
He sees him reigning at the right hand on high, that he rules and reigns, right? When they see him in the book of Revelation and they see the lamb that was slain for all eternity, he's still on the throne. He's still lifted up. He's still high.
Well, you know,
right?
It's interesting that you're saying that, because we even see this in Judaism, and I'll explain why. Okay. The term the suffering servant, or as we know it today, is really not a Jewish concept. It is a concept that Moshiach ben Yosef was going to be different, go through some ordeals and die and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But that is mostly a Christian concept, okay? Mm-hmm. I'll tell you why. Because Moshiach ben David is known as a redeemer, a deliverer. Mm-hmm. Moshiach ben Yosef, the same thing as a deliverer, okay? He is supposed to rebuild the Beit HaMikdash, the temple. So in all sense of the word, when you read about Moshiach ben Yosef, he's really a king. He's a ruler.
Yeah, I agree.
So this
he's got authority.
He has authority. So in the same sense, Yeshua, fulfilling the same role, never lost his authority, you know. Mm-hmm. But in the Christian world, for some, I don't know, reason, they want to separate. It's no, suffering, serving. You know, he's not a king. He just came to suffer and die, and that's it. And that's incorrect. No.
The roles are interweaved.
That's right.
And this is a concept for everybody listening. And Rabbi David, please jump in on this. I think this is an important concept. Mm-hmm. Where scripture is black and white, we must be black and white. That's where scripture is gray, we can be gray. These roles interweave, and we don't see a stop or a start for how they flow. He's still the lamb that was slain from before all creation.
Amen.
Even
in
glorified Satan in Shema when we see him, right? In heaven when we see him, right? There's no distinction. He is raised with a glorified body that was never tainted by sin, that still has the marks of his suffering of humanity, right?
Yes. Well, they will see his marks, you know, in the future. They will see his marks.
They're interweaved, right? That's These things are interweaved. And it's important that, and I think the concept that you brought on about the Redeemer is very important, right? Because why is he called Moshiach ben Ephraim? And it's an important concept. And this is more deeper in rabbinic literature than just the Gemara. You're not going to find this in just the simple midrashim that are popular, not midrash rabbah. You need to go deep into the books that are only in Hebrew. You can't translate, and you got to get them in secondary sources unless you know Hebrew really well.
That's right.
I don't know Hebrew well enough to translate this hard Hebrew stuff, right?
Yeah.
I'm working on it, Lord willing, I'll get there, right?
And they're they're very hard to sometimes interpret and translate, but they are there.
They are there. And so just as a sidebar, what makes this difficult is that when we read these midrashim that come from the Middle Ages or even 400, 500, or even come from the 18th century, you don't know what kind of Hebrew they're functioning in when they're operating it. Are they dealing with the Mishnaic Hebrew? Are they writing a biblical Hebrew? Are they writing in this late Hebrew that's a mix of Rashi that's much earlier, that's right? You know, you have this mix of Hebrew terms and phrases and Aramaics coming in. And did they really read a lot of the Zohar? Because if you do, the Zohar is a warped monster mutant of Aramaic, right?
Yes.
That the things that they don't follow any rules, right?
Yes.
So what are they? So it's very difficult. But the point is this, right? Moshiach ben Ephraim. Ephraim is a son of Joseph. So we have this same theme, right?
Uh-huh.
It goes back to this idea that Joseph suffered on behalf of his brothers, and he brought them redemption, salvation, deliverance, right? Not for Joseph being thrown inside of a pit and his father suffering because of the son going through what he went through, right? This father felt pain. Uh-huh. Jacob was hurt for his son. He goes into Egypt, sits on a throne. He reigns at a king dressed in the garbs of the nations, right? His brothers come up to him in need and ask him, and he feeds them, then reveals himself. We can talk more about that later. But this idea that Joseph suffers for his brother, that's why Joseph gets this role of Moshiach ben Joseph.
That's right.
Then we go down, right? So Ephraim is his son. Why Moshiach ben Ephraim? This is something that is more hidden in the text. And I want to read from Midrash, Tefillat, Rav Shimon Bar Yochai, Ben Yochai. It says, the Bat Kol, which is the voice from heaven, will say to Messiah Ben Joseph and his army, just as Joshua did to Jericho and its rulers, so do to the nations of the world. They recite the Shema, they will encircle Jericho, and the wall will collapse at one. It seems that we now have a Moshiach Ben Joshua. Right, that there is this reigning, fighting Messiah, this warrior, fighter. Right, this is the one that we say the angel of the Lord with the sword at his hand. Are you for us? Are you against us in the scriptures? This is the role that we see that Joshua goes into the land in conquest to do what? To take his people to the promised land. This is why we get this role of Moshiach ben Ephraim, as you said, as a deliverer. This is understood that he's going to come and bring deliverance. And he's going to be a warrior.
Amen.
In the manuscripts, in the Midrashim, it says, look, Messiah ben Joseph, and he has an army. And the Lord is going to come with his holy ones, right? Thousands upon thousands,
right?
This is the idea. And let's bring it down, right? Moshiach ben David. Where's David from? Jericho.
Jericho.
Right? Who helped Joshua deliver them into the promised land? Caleb. Where did Caleb have his rulership in? David. In Judah, right? So what we have here is the deliverance happening with the two roles leading them into the promised land. Where we have the role of Ben Ephraim, the warrior, the king. We have that tribe. And then we also have the tribe through Caleb taking the people into the promised land, which are the roles that Messiah takes them to himself.
And the interesting part of it, you know, that, you know, Joshua, you know, is the one that crosses over to the land, you know. And Joshua, another name is what? Yeshua. Which is Yeshua. So we see there the sign of the Messiah, the one who takes you to the promised land.
Yeshua ben Yehoshua.
That's right. So we see all these things, as you were saying, brother, all these things tie into one another and show us that, you know, I mean, you literally have to be blind or not wanting to see it to see how all these things correlate together, how they all go together, and to show you that these two figures, these two prophetic in biblical eschatology figures, because these, see, the thing about it is, these terms of the Moshiach ben Yosef, Moshiach ben David, were not to happen in later, in earlier times in Israel, but were supposed to happen in the end of days. And we see this, that, you know, the end of days really began when Yeshua came on the earth. When Yeshua was here preaching, that's when the end of days began, because he was just beginning to start. He was, you know, as he said, this is the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is before you. He was the kingdom of heaven, Yeshua.
You know, it's this transitional phase, right? Yes, but not yet.
Yes,
but not yet. The kingdom of God is here. John the Immerser, right, comes around. Look, the kingdom of God is near. Repent, right? Look, John's immersion is different than the immersion we participate in now, right? His immersion was an immersion of preparation for the kingdom of God to descend. And in Yeshua, we have that descension, right?
Yes,
but not yet, right? It's here, but not in its full culmination, right? I just want to keep going on that Judah and Ephraim theme, right? There's a, in the Zohar, because we haven't quoted any Zohar, Zohar Volume 3, just so you know, this covers all different facets of rabbinic literature.
Of course.
It's not just in one little place, right? So your viewers know, I know you know that, but so your viewers know, this is all over, right? It's in the secret stuff. It's in the main stuff. It's only in Hebrew. It's in the Gemara. It's all over written rabbinic literature, right? So in the third volume of the Zohar, we have this idea, and this, the Zohar is really, it's kind of like a midrash, but it's very esoteric, meaning it's full of symbolism, it's full of imagery, it's full of, it kind of sounds like the book of Revelation read backwards, it's kind of awkward, right?
Right.
It's got a lot of stuff, and sometimes you're scratching your head, but it touches on a commentary on Isaiah 53, it touches on the idea of Messiah ben Yosef. This is what it says, right? You have suffered for their sake many troubles so that the Messiah son of Joseph should not be killed. Of whom it says he has the face of an ox. And then they quote Ezekiel, right? He's a descendant of Joseph, of whom it says the firstling of his herd, grandeur is his, right? That's because he and his descendants shall not be violated. And it goes on, right? And then it says, but he was wounded because of our transgressions, and by his injury we are healed. Why does the writer of the Zohar take the imagery of an ox from Ezekiel, which is an exile theme, right? He's by the rivers of Kavar, right? Remember that the fact that Adonai Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh left the promised land, left Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel, and went over to Babylon would have blew the minds of people in the ancient world, because gods were territorial.
That's right.
So if you worship the god of this particular place, he stayed in that place. The Lord of hosts doesn't have a place. He doesn't have a home base. The whole world is his, right?
Correct.
So the idea, Ezekiel sees these visions, which are these visions. They're in the images of the Babylonian gods, and Adonai is above these images. And here goes this ox face, which is one of the faces of the things. And so why the ox? And it says he is a descendant of Joseph. Who is a descendant of Joseph? Descendant of Ephraim. This is Joshua again, right? And I'm going to take it back to you, right? Of Joseph, and it says, when Moses is given his prophetic utterances and praying over the people of Joseph, he says, blessed of the Lord be his land. And talking of Joseph, right?
Amen.
He says, as the firstborn of his ox, majesty is his, and his horns are the horns of the wild ox. This is the idea. The rabbis have knit together this biblical concept of the idea of the ox being paired with Joshua, being paired with the suffering servant, being paired with redemption, and being paired with exile and future redemption. This is the worth of rabbinic literature, that it takes us back to the true inspired words of the Lord.
Amen, amen. And that's the whole thing, that we have to understand this. And I want, you know, we want our viewers to understand, you know, this is not something that was made up yesterday. This goes so deep in so many areas in Judaism that you could find this, you know. And lately, I would say probably within the past 20 years, it's actually came into the Christian world as well. They don't fully understand it, but we do see this in Scripture. As a matter of fact, you know, one of the interesting things about Moshiach ben Yosef, we're saying, you know, as I said earlier, he is to be a redeemer. So he is to be a king, some type of ruler, some type. He's supposed to be a political leader, according to what Judaism teaches. He's also one to rebuild the temple. So we look at this, you know, this character, okay, as we know that in the future we have the Antichrist, the anti-Messiah. Mm-hmm. That will come into the picture. So the anti-Messiah who comes to the picture, remember, you know, what does Hasatan do? Hasatan is an imitator. He wants to do everything that Yeshua did. So doing everything that Yeshua did or anything that's written about the Moshiach, he will also try to fulfill because he wants to be God in every sense of the word. So the Antichrist himself, okay, will be a political leader, okay? The Antichrist himself will be put to death. Okay, we know this because Revelation chapter 13, verse 11 and 12 says, "Then I saw another beast coming out of the earth, and he had two horns like those of a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast in the presence of it that makes the earth. And it says, and his inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed." So he was killed. Okay? Yep. And just like Yeshua who resurrected, he will resurrect. But when he resurrects, he won't be Moshiach ben Yosef. He will be Moshiach ben David in the sense of the word, because also in the book of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4 says, "He who will oppose himself to everything the people that call a god or make an object of worship, he will put himself above all them, so he will sit in the temple of God and proclaim himself to be God." So we see here a dual concept even in the Antichrist. Isn't that crazy? Strange?
And what's awesome, I've never noticed this until you said it, and this is why I love having discussions and just talking about Scripture, because you brought up that horn that the anti-Messiah has, right? Mm-hmm. The ox has the horns, also has horns also.
That's right. Right?
And it wasn't until you said it that I was actually looking at it, right? I saw you caught it too, right? It's like, that's true, right? You
know, it's funny because
so rich, right?
I'm writing these notes for today's show, and I'm, you know, putting stuff down. Yeah. As I'm putting this, I was telling my wife, you know, he's had an epiphany. I said, all of a sudden, crazy. I just realized that even though you kind of like know this, but it doesn't hit you until you really like look at it and say, the Antichrist is going to fulfill both roles.
He has horns.
Yes.
He's falsely fulfilling this utterance of Moses over the tribe of Joshua, right?
Yes.
The tribe of Joseph, I mean, the two sons of Joseph. It's crazy. It's crazy when you think about it, right?
Oh, dude, it goes so far into when we're looking at the Bible, we're looking at these end time characters and what they're going to fulfill, you know. Unfortunately today, you know, we don't have enough time to go into this, you know. We're running to the end of our show. But really, you know, we want to get into, you know, we're going to have you back in a second show, in a part two, as we get deeper, because we really want to show, you know, that not just what the Antichrist will do also in this role, what Yeshua did in this role, okay, and where do we find at least, I believe is one reference in the Brit Hadashah, we can see this concept. And it's a concept that we probably thought it was something else. We misinterpreted or misunderstood it when we read it, but now we go, now I can see. We'll get into that as we get into the next show. So, Rabbi Royo, our time, unfortunately, is running out for this show. But, you know, we're definitely going to have you for part two. I'm going to have you come out again.
Awesome.
And so we can get even deeper into this, you know.
Yeah.
And we can get into what the Scripture says, you know, concerning this. And, you know, it's an awesome thing. An awesome topic that we're talking about. It's a topic that you really can't handle, not even in two shows, as you were saying. We can talk forever
10 hours,
about
man.
This.
10, 15 hours. We might start to scratch the surface. Yeah.
That's right. We can talk forever about this, but the main thing is that we can touch on it, as Rabbi was telling me, Rabbi Eduardo was telling me before the show, to get people hungry.
Yeah.
For them to be, wow, you know what? I got to look into this, you know, and be hungry about this.
Yeah.
Do you have anything that you want to share with our viewers before you go off the air today?
Yeah, my huge thing, and this is my big thing. I've known people who have abandoned Messiah for Orthodox Judaism, and that is sad. I know brothers and sisters who have been near and dear to me who have abandoned Messiah for the Orthodox perspective, for the Orthodox view, and have turned it back on Messiah. This is why I do this. I don't do this because we just want to share knowledge and show how much we know.
Correct.
It's not about that. You know, I'd much rather go take my son to a pool or to the beach, right? You know, instead of just sharing knowledge for knowledge's sake that does nothing, right? I want the body of Messiah to be equipped with answers to the Jewish people, to the Jewish Amen. Brothers and sisters Amen. Who don't believe in Yeshua. That's the main part of it, right? For the development of the kingdom of God, so that God's people can be strengthened in our faith.
Amen.
And then secondarily, so my Jewish brothers and sisters, even though they might not consider me part of the fold, even though they might say I'm a heretic and I commit averroes, great transgressions.
Yeah, you're my Moshiach, a good Jew. You're everything.
Yeah. So my prayer is the same prayer of Paul, right? My prayer is for my Jewish brothers and sisters, for of who are the covenants and the promises. They will come to know Yeshua. That it's not just in the Tanakh or the Brit Chadashah that we see these things, but our rabbis, the sages, Chazal, too, agree that this is a correct and kosher interpretation of the passage. We are not making something up. Yeshua
Correct.
Is not a foreign Gentile God that
Correct.
Cracked the sky and got rid of Yod Heh Vav Heh Adonai. No, it is not true, brothers and sisters. Yeshua is the Messiah of Israel. He's the Messiah of the nations. And he came in the way that Moses and the prophets came, and he is the hope of the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Amen.
This is the truth, and every eye will see him, every knee will bow, and they will look upon the one whom was pierced, and they will say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is come the name of the Lord, and they will mourn for Moshiach, Yeshua of Nazareth, as they mourn for an only son.
Amen.
And this is my prayer, this is my hope, and we are available to you in a real personal way. Email us, reach out to us. We are available. I'm definitely available to answer questions and talk to people, believers, skeptics, people with more questions.
Well,
this is what it's about, brothers and sisters.
This is the thing, the reason why we have this show, you know, part of our show has many different views, different things that we do here, but different type of context. But we want to make sure that when we talk about biblical discussions, we get deep into the Word of Hashem, and we teach people, you know, where we see Yeshua mm-hmm. in Scripture, where he is. He's always been there. As a matter of fact, mm-hmm. I don't even need to have the Brihad Shah to show you Yeshua. I can show you Yeshua in the Tanakh himself, you know, because he is the living word of Hashem. So, and this is the reason why we do this, you know, and we're going to have Rabbi Arroyo back with us. We're going to get deeper into this, but Rabbi
Arroyo. Let me drop one more thing. If I could just say one more thing, because I think it's really important. One of the biggest charge against from Orthodox Jews and even conservative Jews, who may think that the charge is this, you Messianic rabbis, if they even want to call us rabbis, you Messianic rabbis, the only reason why you care about our books, the rabbinic uh-huh. books, is because you want to get us on your side.
Yes.
That is not true.
It's
you
not
need
true.
To understand that the rabbinic literature, as a Jewish person, as a descendant of the Anusim who were persecuted and had an identity stolen and has come back to that identity, right, that uh-huh. walk of Yisrael and coming back to my people, whether you accept me or not. This is the point. Rabbinic literature, it is my heritage as well. It is the heritage of the Messianic community Amen. As well. And when I read it, I am enriched by it, not because it's inspired by God, but because at the points that it takes me back to the text, it confirms that God has left pieces of truth within his people.
That's
and
right.
the Lord has fulfilled his promise, and he will continue to do that. This
Amen.
Is the point of rabbinic literature.
Right.
It is edifying to me, not because it speaks absolute truth.
Uh-huh.
It is because the Lord uses it to draw his people back to himself.
Correct.
The
Correct.
Main one doing apologetics to get the Jewish people to himself is the Lord himself within your own manuscripts.
That's right. And then we quote from these books only to enlighten people, to show you what they believed back then. And although there may
Amen.
Be, let's say, five or six rabbis that are having discussions that completely are off the wall, there may be that one rabbi that has a clear picture that maybe
Amen.
He was seeing something the rest wasn't. And those are the ones we want to reach and tap into that are found in our Jewish literature. So, Rabbi Arroyo, please tell us where people can support your ministry by donations and find on the web.
Sure. So, Congregation Beth El Gibor, House of the Mighty God, is at www.bethelgibor.org, BethElgibor.org. You can donate there to the congregation, to the community. You can watch our live streams on YouTube by typing in Beth El Gibor, Congregation Beth El Gibor, to pop up. We have about 150 services that we've done over the past couple of years. You can catch them on. You can go to our website. We have liturgical stuff on there. We have a little calendar that we're doing where we're reading the whole Word of God through the whole year. If you want to listen to my podcast, Messianic Judaism Unraveled, just go to YouTube, type in Rabbi Eduardo. It'll pop up. Also, if you want to go to my website, rabbieduardo.com, you can just go on the website, see some papers I've written, some stuff that I've done. college papers I've written about rabbinic literature, different things like that. You can access my channel there and reach out to me.
Amen, amen. So amen. As we just said, we're going to have Rabbi Eduardo Arroyo come back out to join us for part two, which will be actually the next show that comes up, to finish this deep biblical discussion about Moshiach ben Yosef and Moshiach ben David. But Rabbi, just hold on for a second before you go, okay? This is coming next in our program. Okay, we want to thank so much for coming out here, Rabbi Eduardo, you know, for doing this, taking time of your busy schedule to be part of the show, and we look forward to seeing you again in part two of this, and so we can finish this deep biblical discussion. Thank you so much for joining us.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Blessings.
Amen. So don't go anywhere. We'll talk more. This is, you know, we talked about what's coming next, so he is coming soon again in our next broadcast. We can talk deeper and deeper about this topic. So please, support this ministry by going to our webpage, bethemanuel.org. You can send your donations there. Please indicate on PayPal that is for walking in the footsteps of Moshiach. If you write to us to ask biblical questions for our guests or on the show, you know, or for myself, you can write to us at Congregation Beth Emanuel, Phila@gmail.com. Amen. And again, we want to encourage you to tell your friends, subscribe, you know, tell them, look, something's going on. This messianic show we just found that we have special guests coming on. We have people from the messianic movement all over the world. And if you're one out there who preaches the word of God, who is a messianic believer, you're a rabbi, you're an artist, you're a musician, you have a special talent, we want to know about you. Write to us. Let us know who you are so we can interview you. And we'll see you next time on walking in the footsteps of Moshiach. Everyone, shalom.